So, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Yohann Barthélémy. I'm a lecturer at the Smart Infrastructure Facility, and over there, I have the pleasure to lead the Digital Living Lab. So, the Digital Living Lab is a research lab which is all about smart cities. So, as you can expect, I have no experience when it comes to Antarctica research, but I'm really keen to learn and work with you. In smart cities application, I'm actually really looking at how to build smart sensors, so how to embed artificial intelligence in devices connected at the edge of the network. Because I'm doing a lot of work in IoT and connected devices, I need a wireless network to transmit the data. And I'm sure you're aware, but there are a lot of networks available out there. So you could use 4G, 3G, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, you name it. But to kickstart our journey into the IoT and connected world, UOW and the Digital Living Lab decided to roll out a LoRaWAN network. So the LoRaWAN network is a wireless network very well suited for IoT or Internet of Things devices, because first of all, it's very long range. So we can transmit data up to 800 kilometers away. Even though we've got a very long range, it's still very low power. So we are using less than 25 milliwatts per transmission. It's scalable. So with one gateway, we can handle more than 1,000 devices on the field. But it comes at a small price. So it's long range, low power, it's fantastic. The thing is, it's very low bandwidth. So it means that you can only transmit maybe one text message every minute. So don't expect to watch Netflix or listen to Spotify with that kind of network. The other thing is that kind of technology, LoRaWAN networks, they are free to use. So anyone can actually use the network to transmit data or install their own sensors. Why? It's simply because we are using the ISM, unlicensed radio band. And the other thing that is great about that and very good for research and smart cities application and citizen science, it's that the network is open. So really anyone can look into the technology and play with it. So at the bottom, you can see actually the world record for the data transmission that was set less than a year ago. And we can transmit data from a weather balloon to a gateway located more than 700 kilometers away in Switzerland. So we've got the network, and that was the first thing that started the journey of the Digital Living Lab. But I have to say that my background is actually applied mathematics and agent-based modeling. So how come did I end up in IoT? Well, it's because the very first project we had at the lab was related to beer. And as a Belgian, I couldn't say no to that. So because we had the LoRaWAN network in the region, a small company contacted us and asked us if we could help them to build a smart beer tracker. It turns out that it's a very complex problem and very important one for the industry because Australian people like to take those beer cakes, cut them in half and make nice barbecue with them. So we worked with them, we developed some prototypes, and now they are a bit everywhere. So that was the very first project and was very good 6 months of prototyping. But since then, we started working on air quality sensors. So we look at how we could develop low-cost air quality sensors. We are developing water quality sensors in the shape of an oyster as well. We've been looking at retrofitting existing infrastructure to make some anomaly prediction or predictive maintenance. And we also worked with the community to deploy some sensors in wheelchairs so we can easily map the accessibility of a city for the people with disabilities. So those are the kind of projects we've been working and that relies on, I would say, traditional sensors. So you've got something that sends data and transmits the raw output right away. But there are so much more things that we can actually do. So instead of transmitting the data to the final application and the application processing the data there, what we can do is moving the processing or the algorithms into the sensor. So that's what we have on the left-hand side. So we want to deploy AI algorithms able to process video feed or noise or any kind of input on the edge, right where the data is produced. So that's what we call edge computing. And then, because the processing is done there, we can just transmit what is relevant for you. So it can be just a couple of indicators, the number of people we've seen, the number of cats we've seen, or the number of birds we could listen to. Because we are also relying on AI in those little devices, and AI can be machine learning or deep learning, we need to train the model, and that's typically done offline. So that's what we have on the right-hand side. So that's where we put the training machine. So we need a database there, we train the AI, and then we push the model to the device. The device can then use that model, but also keep collecting data and also further refine its learning. So that kind of edge computing framework, that's what we call the artificial intelligence of things. It has some good characteristics. For instance, the first one is we don't need a lot of bandwidth to transmit the data. Imagine if you've got 100 camera in the field, you would need gigabytes of bandwidth to be able to transport that data to wherever you want to process it. It's very good when you have some latency issues. So if you want or if you need to process something very quickly and react to that in real time, it's better to process the information on the spot there and not having traveling everywhere in the network. Edge computing can also work when you don't have any network connectivity because it does the processing on the spot. You don't really care about the processing. You don't really care about the network connectivity. And finally, and that might not be a big issue for Antarctica, but it's very good when you have privacy issues. Why? Because we do not transmit any images or noise over the network, just metadata and indicators. And I'll just go through on some project that we've done in the past. So the first one would have been the Liverpool Smart Pedestrian. So that was really a smart city application. And Liverpool wanted to understand what's happening in their CBD in terms of traffic. So what's the interaction between the people and the cars and the bicycle, et cetera, et cetera. Discussing with them, we found out that they had a network of CCTV already deployed there. So that's what you can see on the map in the middle. And so we propose them to deploy an artificial intelligence that is able to first detect the object of interest, so the cars and the pedestrian, but also do the tracking of those objects of interest inside the field of view of the camera. So it means that the AI is able to give an ID to a pedestrian or a car while it is in the field of view. So if you get outside of the field of view and come back in, you'll get a new ID. So we are not Big Brother, we are Smart Brother. So that's actually the output of the AI. We just have some indicators, some time series information about the number of people or vehicles, for instance. You can get access to the trajectories because it's simply a time series of coordinates. We can have heat maps of detections. So again, the user or what's being stored in the database, it's just relevant information for you. We applied that kind of methodology in different projects. So here we've got the SharkEye application. And that's when we actually deployed an AI in a blimp that goes above the beaches, and it's able to detect in real time people swimming in the sea or people doing some surf, but also sharks. So when the smart camera detects a shark based on a deep learning algorithm, then we can transmit right away an alert to mobile application. And we can say, guys, it's time to get out of the sea. It's not safe anymore. Another type of early warning system that we're developing with Wollongong City is stop block. So that's where we want to do an early detection of culvert blockage. Detecting that early is really important because if the culvert is blocked, it will have a huge impact during the next storm event. So it will have a lot of flooding because of that. That system, what makes it very special, it's because it's autonomous. So we actually make sure that we can deploy it on its own anywhere. It's solar powered, it runs 24/7, and thus it has been optimized for power consumption. So we optimized the accuracy of the detection, but also we optimize the software, the AI, so it doesn't use too much power when it does the processing. Monitoring critical infrastructure is something that we do from time to time. And when I say I don't do anything related to Antarctica, it's quite the opposite. Actually, I'm going into the outback, but it's very hot, where we want to monitor pipelines. So we are developing a system now to monitor if there are some intrusion into the pipelines right of ways. So if there is a crane or an excavator going there, then the smart camera that we're developing will transmit an alert to the authorities. The system, again, is fully autonomous, so it's powered via solar panels. And because we don't have any network connectivity over there, we just use satellite transmission. We can do that because we just send a ping, an alert there, and not an image. So it's not that expensive. Playing with RGB camera is one thing we do, but we also investigate other type of data. So we also adapted the AI to understand thermal imagery, for instance. Here in Liverpool and Campbelltown, we've got a thermal camera paired with the algorithm, which is able to do some people counting and people detection. Also people tracking, so similar to the previous project. And in addition, we also train the algorithm to extract the background temperature. So we use that to know where the people go when there is some kind of heat wave. Multispectral is also something that is quite common out there, so we wanted to give it a go. And we had a small project in Vietnam with rice farmers. So what they wanted us to do is to fly above the rice farm very low and capture some multispectral images. And then we process that using deep learning and computer vision. We extract the grains from the image, and then looking at the reflectance data, we can also extract or estimate the moisture content of the rice. A pet project, and again, another type of data that we play with at the lab is noise. So here, this project is all about estimating the population of birds. We wanted to do that using camera, but it turns out that those little things fly everywhere. They're very hard to capture on camera unless you're very lucky. So it's way easier and it makes more sense to just listen to them, except when it's a live bird, of course. But the process is still the same as computer vision. We get the data stream, we process it, we put it through a deep learning algorithm, and voila, you've got your bird counting algorithm. Another type of sensor, again, to monitor the environment, is something based on LiDAR. Wollongong, again, asks us to monitor when estuaries, and more specifically, the height of the estuaries. And we do that by pairing a LiDAR sensor with an edge computer. So the LiDAR collects closed data points, and the edge computer then processes everything, builds the elevation map for the area, and then we just transmit that information to a dashboard where the city council can check whether or not the sand burn is too high. If it is, then we need to send someone there to breach it mechanically. All those algorithms, that's AI, that's machine learning, deep learning, relies on a lot of data for training. And sometimes you don't have that kind of data available. I mean, for the covered blockage, for instance, there were no data sets available anywhere in the world. So what we end up doing is to build our own synthetic data generators, and they are based on game engines. So we just use a 3D game engine. We build the environment that we want, and then we can play with the different lightning condition, weather condition, different type of scenarios to create the data set we need for training the AI. Now we are working with NVIDIA for making better generators. So we are going to look at using ray tracing to make the pictures more realistic. As you can see, we've been playing with a lot of different sensors. So the regular one, the smart one, we've been playing with a lot of different types of data. And we can transmit the data using different type of networks. So we like LoRaWAN, but we don't use LoRaWAN only. We are completely agnostic. We just want to use the right tool for the job. So we use sometimes Wi-Fi or 4G. So it can quickly become a mess when you have the combination of wireless technology and protocols and sensor data. So we are designing our own IoT core to ingest any kind of data. And that core is built on top of open and standard technologies. So there we've got a single entry point for anyone that wants to build their own dashboard or build some nice application. That's what we share with high school, for instance. Or we can use it to do some serious data analytics and modeling as well. So that's there's some kind of example here. So the first thing we try to do is some data fusion. So we know we've got visual sensors in Liverpool, so we've got 20 cameras in the CBD, but we also co-located air quality sensors there to understand the air quality in the city. So on the top right, you've got, for instance, the evolution of the traffic over time, and the graph on the bottom is the air quality over time as well. So now that we've got that data, we can build correlations between the two, and you can try to model, for instance, the air quality based on the traffic, or make the opposite. So if one of the sensors comes offline for whatever reason, we can still try to get an estimated value based on the context. Another thing we do also is to use a lot of all this sensor information, so water level, rain gauge, and radar data from the Bureau of Meteorology, for instance, to inform a big hydrology model for the city of Wollongong. So that helps us to predict in real time what are the floods or what are the risks for flooding in the region. So that's everything we've done in the past. And what can we do for SAFE, or what do we want to do for this ARC program? Well, we are thinking about developing and also developing the testing facilities for an intelligent ground-based monitoring station and using all the experience we learned in the past project and put it into that new monitoring box. So we were looking at environmental sensing using some kind of AI, and we want it to be long range. So using either LoRaWAN or satellite transmission, which won't be a problem because we want to use the edge computing paradigm. And we wanted to make it as easy as possible to use. So just drop somewhere and then come back in a few months to get or retrieve the box when you're done with it, or you want to look at another location. So that would be the idea. We get the remote monitoring station box with an edge computer, some kind of batteries and heating system to make sure it survives. The challenge would be, of course, the power. How are we going to power that? We need to look into that. But then it can look at, it can monitor the animals. It can look at mosses, or it can do some environmental sensing like weather, humidity, pressure, etc., and transmit the output, the relevant information via satellite or LoRaWAN to the SAFE community. That is here just an example of what could be done on the spot by that kind of remote monitoring station. So we got a camera looking at mosses base, and then you can apply some segmentation algorithm to extract the proportion of healthy and stressed moss, as well as the proportion of rock and snow in the picture. I know I've been a bit fast, but there's so many things you want to say in 15 minutes. So thanks a lot. And yeah, if you want to discuss more, happy to do.